It's September 25th, 1984. I am Bill Watson, the Deputy Director of CDC, and with me today is Dr. Robert J. Anderson, who was the chief, that was the title we used in those days, of CDC from October 1956 to June of 1960. Is that right, Dr.
Anderson? Yes, sir.
And perhaps we could start by talking about your life and career before you arrived at CDC. You had already had a rather distinguished public health service by that time. But let's start. You're a Minnesotan, right?
Yes, I was born in Zumbrota, Minnesota, and grew up there and went to medical school at the University of Minnesota, and then joined the public health service at the time.
How did that come about?
It came about because I took a public health service internship at the Public Health Service Hospital in Staten Island, which at that time was, those hospitals were called the U.S. Marine Hospitals,
right,
because we took care of the Merchant Marine and the Coast Guard.
I see.
And then I got into the Regular Corps.
Then?
That was in 1939. And I got into the Regular Corps the following July 1, and I stayed in the Public Health Service for most of my professional career.
How did you spend World War II? You were in the Public Health Service.
Well, I was in the Public Health Service, and the first thing that I did with regard to that period was I was assigned to the, continued to be assigned to the Staten Island Hospital, where I had service on the venereal disease service of the hospital.
Oh, really?
And I got to know some of the greats in venereal disease work at that time, John Mahoney and C.J. Van Slyke, R.C. Arnold, and Ad Harris, who later became part of CDC,
right,
who were all in the VD laboratory, which was located there at the hospital. And they were working at that time on penicillin and its uses, yes, in the treatment of venereal disease.
Well, Dr. Mahoney is credited with being the first person to treat syphilis with penicillin. Is that right?
I believe that is so.
Yeah, true.
And from there, I was sent out to sea on a Coast Guard cutter.
Oh.
And I had Coast Guard duty. I came back and I thought I was going to be a surgeon, because I started training there at the Staten Island Hospital in surgery. But Dr. Joseph Mountain and a few others decided that I should join the cadre that was being sent out, public health service officers that were being sent out to work on health problems around the newly set up army camps and training installations.
I see, okay.
Where there had been no previous public health services particularly. Mm-hmm. And I ended up being assigned to Missouri, first to a county outside of Fort Leonard Wood, and then secondly to a county at Neosho, which Neosho, Missouri, which where there was a Signal Corps training facility. And Dr. Mountain and Dr. C.C. Applewhite came out and visited me once and convinced me that I should go to take training in public health on a Rockefeller Fellowship, which I did at Columbia University. And then I had a shift in career, because at that time, Dr. Herman Hillebo was beginning to move the tuberculosis program to almost co-equal status with venereal disease control, Bill.
The VD program was one of the largest programs in the public health service during,
yes,
the war, wasn't it?
It certainly was.
Yeah.
And the venereal disease program had a great record of training people of all sorts for responsible positions in the public health service,
right,
in future years.
Exactly.
So Dr. Hillebo drafted me for tuberculosis control.
I see.
And
after you had finished at Columbia?
After I had finished at Columbia, and for many years thereafter I had a career in tuberculosis control.
And you ended up heading up the TB program?
Yes, I became chief of the tuberculosis program in 1947. And that's another story that I want to cover a little bit,
okay,
later, because it,
well, why don't you do
touches
it now?
On CDC. Okay. First, I would like to say a few words about this occasion.
Okay.
It's, as you say, September 25th, and we're going into a period where you are going to be recognized for your contributions to the Public Health Service, and particularly CDC, upon the occasion of your retirement.
That's right.
And when I think of this occasion of me being interviewed about the history of CDC, I'm like a journeyer who went down the CDC road for just a short space of time, 4 years. And Bill, you and I came to CDC at the same time back in 1956.
Right.
And you have almost 30 years experience.
That's right, exactly.
So you'd be a much more appropriate individual to be interviewed about CDC.
But that's not why we're here today.
No, it may not be why we're here. But it brings up something also that I wanted to say that about my relationship to CDC. I knew all of the chiefs of CDC who preceded me. And I've also knew them personally and professionally, and I've also known chiefs of CDC who followed me. And I'm the person who probably has as many chiefs who preceded me as who chiefs who have followed me.
Right.
So
middle,
I'm kind of at the midpoint.
Right. Exactly.
From this point on, everything is, as far as I'm concerned, is on the wrong side of the balance. But being a person who's had temporary contact with CDC, and 4 years is temporary in terms of an organization that soon will have 40 years of experience, all I can do is talk about some of my impressions of CDC and its place in public health from the standpoint of my observations. But the real people who have made CDC all through the years have been the workers, the staff, the colleagues of the chiefs of CDC and its directors and deputy directors and so on, who really made CDC what it was, what it is, and who will make it what it will be in the future. So I would just like to acknowledge that I had a very small role to play in CDC and its total development.
Well, you're being modest. Important years. That you were here.
They were good years. They were exciting years, Bill. And I think this is true for everybody who's ever had any contact with CDC, that their contact with it has been exciting, fun, professionally rewarding.
That's right.
My contact began when I was chief of the tuberculosis program. At that time, malaria control in war areas had, this was 1947, had really phased down its activities, and a new framework for CDC was being built by Mark Hollis, Justin Andrews, Seward Miller. L.L. Williams had gone on to international health work, and the laboratory activities of CDC under Seward Miller were being developed. The venereal disease program had moved laboratory from Staten Island, where Ad Harris and his group worked, down here to CDC under Seward Miller and fitted it into the lab branch. Tuberculosis was a relatively young program and did not have any laboratory activity when it was set up. Mm-hmm. However, the diagnosis of tuberculosis depended so much upon laboratory work. Microscopic and bacteriological identification of tubercle bacilli and the variants thereof, that we sent off Dr. Martin Cummings to the State Serum Institute in Denmark for training. The State Serum Institute was connected with WHO and was a recognized world prime place for tuberculosis bacteriology. He came back in 1947 and preparatory for his work in a tuberculosis division laboratory, my responsibility was to decide where that laboratory should be established. Mm-hmm. One of the possibilities would have been to establish it in connection with one of the United States recognized laboratories in tuberculosis work. The other possibility was to set it up down here within the Public Health Service laboratory activity at CDC because it fitted with the ideas that CDC was developing for laboratory services which would hit at the problems of diagnosis of diseases by laboratory methods used in clinical laboratories and in state health department laboratories around the states. So I came down and negotiated with Mark Hollis and Justin Andrews and Seward Miller about this laboratory, and we set it up down here. I understand that one of the persons that we put into that laboratory in those early days, Mae Melvin, is still here at CDC working in the laboratory, and I think that's wonderful. She was a great trainer.
Dr. Melvin is still here.
So we got the laboratory set up, and it's been here ever since. I guess there still is a TB laboratory
here. There is, at Chamblee.
Good. Yes. Subsequent to that, my own career went from being chief of the tuberculosis division to chief of the tuberculosis and chronic disease division. And then when there was one of the inevitable reorganizations of the Public Health Service, there was a division created called the Division of Special Health Services.
I remember that. I sure
which am. You and the VD program were part of, as well as the TB and chronic disease programs were part of. And my job there was to be the deputy to Seward Miller as the head of research in that division. And that's really where I first got to know you up there in Washington. When the VD program was located in a temporary building, World War II building, on the south side of the mall, near where the Air and Space Museum is located now. And we worked together at that time, and then when I was to become chief of CDC, the decision was made to move the venereal disease program down here.
I want to ask a question about that. That's the way CDC has grown in great part, is by the transfer in of ongoing functions from other places in the public health service. There have been nine of those, and the VD transfer was the first. Can you give us a little background on how that occurred? Who made that decision?
Bill, I don't know who made that decision. I was not privy to the discussions that went into it.
Well, you were not.
I was not. Dr. Bauer would probably be better able to answer that question because Dr. Bauer had been in the venereal disease program and its director, I believe, before he came down to CDC.
Right. And he was your predecessor.
And he was my predecessor here. When I learned that I was to come here to CDC and that VD was being transferred down.
That was part of what you were told at the time.
I was told that. I also said, well, let's move tuberculosis down here at the same time. I said, after all, I've been the TB chief, the TB people know me, and I have a few credits with them that maybe I can play on now to make this move a little more palatable. Because any time you move a large number of people from one physical location to another, and also change their organizational relationships, there are bound to be tensions.
That's right.
Some people will welcome the change, some won't make any difference to, and some will fight it.
That's right.
As best they can.
That's exactly what happened in the transfer of VD.
I remember that. And I have always wanted to tell you, Bill, that I appreciate very much your role in making that transition as smooth as possible.
Well,
we lost some good people from the VD program who chose to remain in Washington. But Larry Smith, who came down with me as deputy and then succeeded me as chief of CDC, and you and Bill Brown, who became the chief of the VD program, did a fantastic job of making that transition as good as it could possibly be made.
Well,
I was told, however, that on tuberculosis, they would not let tuberculosis come down with me. And I guess jokingly, they said that if I got tuberculosis down here, this would become the tuberculosis center instead of CDC.
Yeah.
So
That transfer subsequently took place when Dr. Smith was director.
Yes. Yes. And again, it was a traumatic episode.
Right. Oh, it sure was. They all were.
Oh, they, you
every
can't
one
do
of them
it.
Has been. That's right.
Recently, you've had the same problem with the NIOSH, the Institute of Occupational Safety and Health, I'm sure. But anyway, you and I got down here and we went to work. But I'd like to pick up the thread now on what my own personal career was.
Right, yes, exactly.
When I left CDC, I went back to Washington. I was ordered back to Washington. And Ted had me as his deputy chief of the Bureau of State Services. In the late 50s, there was beginning to be a recognition that environmental health was an area of importance to the Public Health Service. And the congressional committees called upon the Public Health Service to do a study and a report on environmental health, which came out, I think, in 1959. And this led to my being called back to Washington to be Ted Bauer's deputy to emphasize the environmental health programs of the Bureau of State Services. And Ted, for the most part, took care of the personal health services and the community health services, and I, for the most part, worked on the environmental side. When he retired and I was the Bureau of State Services, then Aaron Christensen, who also was an old VD man, became my deputy, and he concentrated again on the community and personal health side.
And you on the environmental?
And I on the environmental side.
Right.
And I worked on that until 1966, when I retired from the Public Health Service. I must say that my work at CDC had done quite a bit for me in preparing me for environmental health work, because CDC had at that time a toxicology laboratory under Dr. Whalen J. Jack Hayes.
Jack Hayes.
Which at that time was located down at Savannah.
Right.
Sib Simmons and his technology branch were very much concerned about the control of insects through not only pesticide means, through biological controls, the regulation of irrigation practices, the leveling of lands so that water wouldn't puddle in certain areas and breed insects. And also at that time, in those programs here at CDC in the 50s to the 60s, there was a lot of interagency contact with agriculture and interior, Fish and Wildlife Service, Bureau of Land Management, Bureau of Reclamation, and I got involved in some of those kinds of activities. So it was a kind of a preparatory activity for me for my later career.
What about the foreign aid program? Subsequently, CDC became very involved with them in malaria control, this particular area of public health, testing their pesticides and helping them in the technical side of
those. Activities in malaria control and pesticide work were in place by the time I arrived.
I see.
And they continued.
Okay.
CDC had its start, I guess, in international health work in that insect disease control area.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it broadened, even during my time, into other areas of public health activity. When I left the Public Health Service, I went back to, I guess, my initial career. I went back to the womb and got to be the medical director of the Tuberculosis and Respiratory Disease Association. And subsequently, in 1970, I became the managing director, succeeding Dr. James Perkins, of the association, which then became known as the American Lung Association, as it is known now. And I retired from them in 1974. And for the part, I've enjoyed retirement since then.
Well, the last decade then.
Right.
Living in the Washington area.
10 years. I'm awfully young to be retired.
Right, exactly.
But this is kind of the setting in which I learned about CDC and what happened to me subsequent to CDC. When well, you mentioned international health, and I guess I'll come international health activities, and I'll come back to that in a little bit.
Well, I have some specific questions about things that happened while you were chief of CDC. The first buildings here on Clifton Road were built. It's my understanding that although the buildings had been designed, the Korean War came along and the actual construction was delayed. After you got here is when that building program actually took place. Am I right on that front?
Yes. A lot of preliminary work to my period, which was preliminary to my role, had been done. The problems at Chambly were really quite terrible from the standpoint of operating laboratories where you were trying to do controlled, secure laboratory work in buildings that were old barracks buildings or old hospital wards.
Incidentally, and it was only still there. We're still using them.
Well,
I've
heard that. But Hollis and Justin Andrews and Vondelier and Ted Bauer and the people in CDC prior to my time had all been hoping and planning and dreaming of the day when CDC would have its own institutional facility, which would be a permanent one. And it really was important that an organization which had the potentials that CDC had have a physical facility, an institutional physical facility, which would give it identity and permanence.
Right, exactly.
And when they sent me down here, they said, Anderson, your prime job down there is to get that building program underway. So that was what I was sent down here for.
That was your bureau director or the surgeon general?
Well, just about everybody.
Everybody at headquarters
in
Washington. Right,
yeah. Particularly in the public health service. Because it had never moved in this year is for
That's
one
right.
reason or another.
Right.
And so we went to work on it. And we had to redraw a lot of the preliminary planning that had been done. And Shackelford and Bob Shackelford and Ross Buck took on the responsibility in the planning activities, the facilities planning office with Jim Payne. And then with the technical people, Ralph Hogan, Petty Coco, Earl Arnold, Morris Schaefer,
yes.
and all of the laboratory people who had their own particular ideas how their laboratories should be designed, went to work to do this. But the first thing was we had to go to Congress and get an appropriation for planning money, which I did. And we went through the bureau offices. We had good help from Steve Ackerman, from Ted Bauer. We went to the Surgeon General's office where Luther Terry.
This,
I mean,
this would have been.
This was Lee Birney's time.
This would have been 1957, or roughly.
57. Well, by the time we hit the appropriations process, it would have been 57.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
For calendar year 58.
Right.
Fiscal year 58, excuse me. And Harry Dorn and in the for Lee Birney.
The Surgeon General.
And for the Surgeon General. And Marion Folsom's budget officer who. Whose name escapes me for the minute.
Jim?
No, not Jim Kelly.
Not
he's
Jim Kelly.
Predecessor of Jim
oh,
Kelly.
Jim. Okay.
He was had been a long time chief budget officer for the HEW. Okay. He has a daughter who lives in Atlanta.
Okay. I'm blanking on that name too.
I want to say Roy, but that isn't it. Yeah, Harlow.
Harlow.
Yeah.
Right. Roy.
Wasn't it Roy Harlow?
Roy Harlow, right.
Roy Harlow. Right. And Marion Folsom, and subsequently...
Who was the secretary.
Who was the secretary, and subsequently Jim Kelly and Secretary Arthur Fleming all got involved in backing this. And we got it through the Bureau of the Budget, which is always quite an achievement.
Right.
And over to the Congress, where I was very fortunate to have had many years' experience of working with Congressman John Fogerty and Senator Lister Hill, who had come to know me very well and I to know them very well. And by golly, we got the planning money.
Good.
And then it went on to the construction money and so on. My only I had one little problem.
Were you involved at all in the negotiations with Emory about the building?
Oh, yes.
Did that, okay.
Yes. One of the things that we had to get was a place to build the facility. And the wisdom was that if we could come up with donated land, that this would remove one great obstacle to getting the building program underway. And Ted Bauer and maybe others before him had developed good contacts with Dr. Beaufilet Jones of Emory University, who was vice president for health affairs, and others at Emory University, like the dean of the medical school, Dr. Richardson, which all I picked up on. And the first thing that we had to do was, did Emory have some land that they would donate to the government? It seemed advantageous because of our, not only our top level contacts, but also some of the contacts between scientists, that if we could foster a relationship with Emory University through physical proximity and other tries, that this would be advantageous. And this led to the identification of this piece of property here on Clifton Road as the one that was most logical for Emory to make available. Now, I want to tell you that when I was involved in getting this thing planned, my idea was that all of CDC should be housed on this property at Clifton Road. And we would close up Chambly, we would close up Savannah, we would close up the virus and rickettsia laboratory at Montgomery, move all of that in here to Atlanta, and we would have a complete unified entity for CDC. And I was a little concerned that the topography of this piece of ground and the size of it might not accommodate enough future growth after we had gotten everything together, and I didn't want us to have to begin fanning stuff out again, going back to Chambly. Excuse me. So our planning, I was a little reluctant to accept this piece of ground because I had a faint glimmer that in time CDC might grow and this piece of ground might not be able to house everything.
Big enough.
So anyway, we went ahead and signed the papers with to take over this land for the government. And Ross and the others went ahead with the planning activity and we got the money. Went to work to the construction phase, and at some point along the line, Ross came back to Len Abbey, who was the budget officer at the time, to tell me that I hadn't gotten them enough money. And I needed to go back and get almost twice as much money as I'd already gotten.
For the actual construction.
I think this was for the actual construction.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And we were, I don't remember at what phase in the construction program we were. Ross Buck could probably tell you about this. And Ross will also tell you about how I darn near fell out of my chair and pleaded with them not to give me that assignment to and have to ask for twice as much money because I was afraid it might endanger the project. Nonetheless, we did, and we got the money. Ross and the others working with him did a fantastic job of working with and overseeing the Roberts Construction Company, which did the actual construction of this building. It was really quite an operation, Bill, and I really marveled at how we started from the fall of 1956 and had this building ready, this plant ready, as it was then conceived, ready for occupancy on July 1st, 1960.
Right.
The day after I was relieved from responsibility.
Yeah, that's interesting, too.
Well,
you never really worked in these buildings.
I very carefully designed a corner office up here on the second floor. That was one area that I really kept track of for my use. And I never got to sit in it as chief of CDC. There are some other, what I think are interesting stories. I'm not sure they're important, excepting they are a reflection of the times. And the times affected us at CDC. You remember the Supreme Court decision in 1954 about the desegregation of schools?
Right, I sure do.
And this was one of the troublesome problems when we talked about staff moving down here, because people were afraid that the schools might be closed and their children would have no place to go.
I know. I had those concerns myself.
I did too.
Yes, right.
Well, CDC, when we came down, was located in what we call the Peachtree 7th building.
Right.
Peachtree and 7th Street Northeast. And we occupied one whole floor and a floor up above there. We had no black persons on our staff at that time in that facility. We had just two toilet facilities, one marked men and one marked women. And in those days, in this part of the world, black persons did not use the same toilet facilities that white persons used. And we had a real problem with regard to how we would react to this kind of a situation when we wanted to add black persons to our staff. But this racial problem affected us with regard to the construction of this building.
Oh.
One of the things was that happened was that the Georgia Power and Light Company had to run special power lines in here to the construction site as construction was to take place. And one of the things that was required in that contract was that Georgia Power and Light had to agree to post along the right-of-way for that power line signs saying that Georgia Power and Light Company was an equal employment opportunity
the federal requirement
employer,
yeah.
Yes, sir,
uh-huh. Okay.
And that this had to be posted. Well, Georgia Power and Light wasn't about to sign that clause into the contract, and Johnson and John Barron and George Trimble worked with officials at Georgia Power and Light to try to soften their position on this, and they just refused. So I had to report back up through channels.
The power company wouldn't
get. That the power company will not sign the contract, and we won't get power to build the building because of this clause.
This is a story I've never heard. It's fascinating.
And within a short space of time, word came back down from Secretary Arthur Fleming at the time. And you know, he went on to be the chairman of the Civil Rights Commission.
Right.
But Secretary Fleming sent word back down to Dr. Anderson and Mr. Lyle, who was the regional director for HEW, and also located in the Peachtree 7th building, go to Georgia Power and Light Company and educate them so that this little obstacle could be overcome. So Mr. Lyle and I made an appointment with the top dog of Georgia Power and Light Company to go down and visit him in his office. And Mr. Lyle and I rode down together in the car, and Mr. Lyle was telling me about how important this was and everything. So we get into the head man's private office, and it turns out that Mr. Lyle and the chief officer of Georgia Power and Light attended the same church. And so they talked about church matters and about their friends and acquaintances that were in the church for maybe like five or ten minutes. And I thought, gee, this is great. Mr. Lyle is going to be able to finish this education very quickly. But as the conversation lagged on church matters, it arrived at the point where Mr. Lyle turned to me and he says, "Well, now, Dr. Anderson, what was it we came here to talk about?"
He handed you that one, huh?
Handed me that one, and it caught me quite by surprise, and I reacted instantaneously, and I said, "I understand you won't sign the contract with that clause in it. And we want that clause in the contract." The top man at Georgia Power and Light, who was sitting in his chair behind his desk, took off like he'd been ejected from a plane into the air and banged the desk, and we went on and on from that point. Ultimately, I've forgotten how it was resolved, but we did get the power for the construction. Later on, he pointed out that Georgia Power and Light, and I relayed all this information back, that Georgia Power and Light had a lot of black employees and had professional employees, particularly in their home economics work, mm-hmm. for education of people in this area. And I don't remember, Bill, just exactly how we got around it.
That's an interesting thing that you bring up, and I think an important aspect of CDC. That was a real problem at that time. We had a problem with housing black people who would come to visit CDC. And finally, if you remember, we worked out an arrangement with a little hotel down the street that they would do this quietly. And this was before Atlanta was integrated. And I remember subsequently, and this was after you had left, I think, we were not able to get everything into this site, and we needed to rent some office space. And a building in Decatur would not rent to us because we insisted that they would sign this kind of agreement on desegregation. And we found a building in Buckhead that would, and that's why we're in Buckhead today. So those early fights on the racial front were very much a part of CDC. And I look back, and it's kind of amazing that we were able to do what we did, given the climate at that time that existed here in Atlanta. Of course, Atlanta turned the corner not too long after you and I
arrived
here.
That's right, yes.
I'm talking now.
Well, you've been party to these things, too.
Exactly.
But another event took place at that time, again, with the racism aspect. In the planning of this plant, we had two kinds of heating systems that we had to incorporate. Mm-hmm. One was an oil-burning facility, and the other one was a natural gas facility. So that in the event of shortages one way or the other, or exceptionally cold weather, we could throw both of them into existence. Well, there weren't any gas lines big enough in this area to take care of our needs. So we had to go to Atlanta Gas Light and ask them to run a gas line out here. And again, the contract that we would sign with Atlanta Gas Light Company was supposed to include this clause. And again, Pick Johnson and John Barron, after lots of efforts, came back and reported they won't, so we can't get gas for this physical plant. This would have killed it for sure.
Yeah.
So, again, I reported what the situation was, that we couldn't get the Atlanta Gas Light Company to sign this contract. And furthermore, I reported that our investigation showed that other federal facilities had contracts with Atlanta Gas Light Company which did not have this clause in it. John Barron had done the work to ferret this out. And this included a facility, for example, the Atlanta prisons, facility.
The
federal prison.
Penitentiary here.
Which is under the Department of Justice.
Uh-huh, I see. Okay.
And Fort McPherson.
Big ones.
Department of Defense.
Right.
And it was true not only in the immediate Atlanta area, but over in Alabama and several other places where Atlanta Gas Light served. I reported this up, and it resulted in Mr. Fleming inviting me to come to his office so that he could imbue me with the zeal to get this clause into the contract. And I went to the meeting with Secretary Fleming and Jim Kelly and a number of other people, where they immediately started off, you know, that we hadn't done enough work down here. And we told them what work we had done, and also the existence of these contracts with other agencies. And Mr. Fleming hadn't heard of that. Uh-huh. Apparently this hadn't gotten through. And he just couldn't believe it, because he also sat on one of the committees that oversaw this contract activity, along with the Secretary of the Department of Justice and the Secretary of Defense and so on. So finally he says, well, he says, I'm going to check up on this. So he made calls to Justice and Department of Defense. And sure enough, he learned that they did have contracts with Atlanta Gas Light, and they did not include this
clause.
Mm-hmm. So he immediately called over to the staff of the commission that was to oversee this activity for the committee and set up an appointment. And I thought, this is great. The secretary himself is going to go over and take care of this. So I was really very pleased with the outcome of this meeting. Well, when the day came, the meeting was to take place, the secretary couldn't go. So Bob Anderson, James Kelly went over to the commission. And the commission was a real hard-nosed outfit. They thought we were lying. They wouldn't even accept
that these other agencies
had this clause. Mm-hmm. And we had to sit there and wear them down to the point where they would make the calls and find out for themselves, which they finally did. And they finally agreed that this should be something that should be handled across the board rather than on a case-by-case basis, and particularly in a situation like this where it was so important to a construction contract that we had with Chip Roberts. So we got gas, Bill.
You
still
have
gas?
Of the whole federal government is the way that, yes, we do exactly that. We use gas except in very cold weather, and then they shift us over to oil. So it's the same system.
Yeah,
that's exactly the way it is. That's fascinating. And those were, it's almost unbelievable that you had to fight those kind of battles. But that's the way it was.
The way it was. And there were cliffhangers, because if we got a negative on either one of them, you know, things were dead.
Yeah, right. That's fascinating. You've already mentioned your negotiations with the Congress for the building money, and you mentioned Congressman Fogarty and Hill. Could you describe how the process of justifying budgets for programs and so forth operated in those days, because it's quite different now. The system then consisted, as I remember it, of being sure that you had covered yourself with those two very important people in the Congress, Hill and Fogarty. Whereas today we've got just a plethora of congressional committees that we have to deal with. But could you describe that process for us? You indicated that you had a personal kind of relationship with them.
Yes, I did, from the tuberculosis days. Senator Hill, of course, was the author of the Hill-Burton construction program.
Right.
And that program, back in the 40s, was an important program from the standpoint of getting tuberculosis hospital beds, mm-hmm. which now, of course, aren't needed. But anyway, that was important, so there was a contact there with him, and again through his state, which was very important. Mm-hmm. And I also, Senator Hill called me one day and asked me if I'd come over and talk to Justice Black, Hugo Black, on mm-hmm. the Supreme Court about a personal problem that was present in one of Black's friends' families, which I did.
They were both from Alabama.
Both right. from Alabama, right. mm-hmm. which I did, and Hill remembered that. Mm-hmm. In those days, the head of the program, like TB and VD, the chief of those programs was responsible individually to go up at each step in the budget process, first to the Bureau of State Services, and then to the Surgeon General's office, then to the Secretary's office, then over to the Bureau of the Budget, and then over to the Hill, to the congressional committees, justify the appropriations. In those days, it was the appropriations committees that were the important committees.
Right.
There weren't committees of different aspects of these things that were related to legislative authorizations.
That's right. The authorization,
was the basic Public Health Service legislative authority in the Public Health Service Act, which was a very broadly stated authority, and it justified everything we did.
Right. In fact, said to the Surgeon General, shall go forth and do good.
Right.
Almost that.
And
moment.
He tried.
That's
yeah.
right.
So, while we were responsible for justifying this, these appropriation requests, as you might expect, the request of the division, and as you know, the request of the division was not quite agreed to by the Surgeon General's office in every way.
Right.
And the Secretary's office would reduce it a little more, and the Bureau of the Budget for the executive branch would reduce it further. Mm-hmm. And so by the time we hit the congressional committee, the House first and then the Senate, the justifier, the division chief, was expected to justify exactly and no more than the amount of money that was requested by the Bureau of the Budget.
Right.
Well, in those days, the administration with President Eisenhower was of one political faith, and the Congress was of the opposite, Republicans, Democrats. Well, the congressional committees, even some of the Republicans on the congressional committees, were very much interested in health. And so they took the tactic of saying to the witness, now, this is the administration request, but we'd like your professional opinion.
They'd ask for your professional opinion.
Professional opinion as to the adequacy of this program and what things might be missed. Mm-hmm. Well, this always, of course, put the witness on the defensive. Mm-hmm. And Nelson Rockefeller was Assistant Secretary of HEW under Gladys Hobby. And I think it was the first year that this would be, I guess, 53, in February, when we were testifying, that we went over there to the House Committee, which John Fogarty chaired. Mel Laird was on it for the Republicans. And Jack Haldeman was head of the Hospital Facilities and Construction Program. He was the first witness. And the questions came. Now, this is the formal request. We'd like your professional opinion, Dr. Haldeman, as to what this program needs. And Dr. Haldeman then went over immediately to tell them what his ideas were about the appropriation request. Nelson Rockefeller was in the room at the time this was happening. He called Dr. Schaefer, Dr. James Schaefer, who was to testify for the venereal disease program on that occasion, and me out into the hallway.
Rockefeller did,
and gave us a real lecture on what we were expected to do.
Who you work for.
Yeah, right. And Dr. Schaefer went on next, and Fogarty went after him with these kinds of questions. And I went on after Schaefer, and you could see Rockefeller, he wasn't exactly liking what Dr. Schaefer was saying. And when I was testifying, I was busy concentrating on what Fogarty was saying. I wasn't watching Rockefeller. And Fogarty gave me a very rough time.
But you weren't asking for enough.
Yeah, right.
Right.
And he kept after me. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I was back in the South HEW building, and the phone rang, and it was Congressman Fogarty, and he wanted to talk to me, to tell me that there was nothing personal about any of this, and it was fine and dandy, and he thought I had done a good job, and he was all for
it. He understood what you
were
doing.
Trying to do, and that led to a personal contact with John Fogarty that I maintained up until the time he died.
I see.
And he was really a dedicated man, as was Senator Lister Hill to health.
Right, that's your word.
And as far as CDC was concerned, when I got down here, Congressman Fogarty said to me on one occasion early, he said, "Bob," he says, "I'm going to keep track especially of CDC, because you fellows are down there, you're far from Washington, you don't have any great lobby like the National Institutes of Health with Mary Lasker, mm-hmm. and I'm going to help you on CDC." And he did. And even though we were coming in with big budget requests for planning and construction, we also got what, to me at the time, I thought were good increases in our epidemiology intelligence service and in our laboratory service, so that we had program growth as well as building growth at that time. Mm-hmm. Of course, we took advantage of every crisis that came along when the Asian flu epidemic hit soon after I came down here.
In 1957.
1956, yeah. 57. Mm-hmm. We were right there on the door asking for more money for our laboratory work and for our EIS surveillance of the influenza situation.
I see. Yeah, that
and then when the staphylococcal problem in hospital infections arrived on the doorstep, we were right there asking for additional support to do those things, and we got them.
Yeah.
Not to the extent that you have. I saw on your bulletin board downstairs that you now have a whole hospital infections. Is it a center?
No,
it's pretty near it, though. It's a
division.
A huge
the center for infection.
A huge bureaucracy.
Right. Good program.
Yeah.
But we do have a very active hospital infection.
Yeah.
You've talked about the laboratory at CDC and the inference is that it was sound and it was good. And you've just referred to the Epidemic Intelligence Service. That's still with us. Could you describe that a bit and how that operated in your time?
Well, this is a program where this short time traveler, when he came on the road, the program was already in existence. Dr. Langmuir, others, the chiefs of CDC had started it before. And it was a good program because it went out and recruited young persons from medicine, from nursing, from dentistry, from veterinary medicine, from physics, and brought them in to give them an introduction, if you will, into the epidemiological method and its use on health problems. And it did a fantastic job. Dr. Langmuir and his staff did a fantastic job of building up a cadre of persons, not only for CDC, but persons who went back to medical schools, veterinary schools, even into private enterprises, who had this philosophical approach to analyzing public health problems. And I don't remember the numbers of persons that we had under Dr. Langmuir and under D.A. Henderson, who was his prime assistant at that time. I think it was something like 12.
Yeah, it was
12 spots.
Right. It was small.
I am sorry that I didn't have a chance to do any homework on looking at all the documents with regard to facts and figures, you know, to make this a meaningful historical account. You're looking at the world not necessarily the way the world was,
but the way you.
But the way Bob Anderson might remember it.
That's exactly what we want.
And I might construct it a little differently than it actually was. But nonetheless, while it was small.
How big was CDC?
It was good. Well, as I recall, without VD, before VD came down, we were somewheres around 500 persons.
That's my remember.
Totally.
Right.
VD brought with it about another 500 because there was, as you recall, the public health reps that were assigned out
in the field, right.
to the field. Mm-hmm. Another thing that VD brought with it that was very important, I think, was the first time that CDC as such had a grant program.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. Exactly. And these were very important first. So CDC.
And regional offices, if I remember.
That and regional offices,
regional
yes.
Working through regional offices.
Working through
those
regional
were things
offices.
That came at that time, and that are still with us. Very formative years in terms of the way we do business. Right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So CDC had about 1,000 persons at the time I left.
What about the relationship with states in those days? The state health officers and the state epidemiologists and the state lab directors. What is your memory of how?
In my time, the relationships were that Dr. Langmuir, for example, and Dr. Hogan in the laboratory area, Hogan was the chief of the laboratory branch, they both maintained organizational contacts with the state lab directors and the state epidemiologists.
Right.
In the instance of of the Epidemic Intelligence Service, Dr. Langmuir had a few persons who might be assigned out to a state to do state functions as a temporary and as a training measure. They were assigned supposedly to states that had the capacity, the capability to provide good training. In the lab situation, the situation wasn't quite the same because most state laboratories were pretty well developed and had their staffs. I don't remember any lab assignments of lab personnel to the states.
No, I don't think you did that.
As far as my job, of course, was to relate to the state directors of health. And we had the VD public health rep who were assigned out to states again to do state functions.
Right.
Again, coming out, as I recall, Bill, out of the grant money, they were paid out of the grant money that was available. The state had their option, one or the other. In those days, state health departments were not very well developed. They were much better developed than they were 20 years earlier.
Mm-hmm.
When I got into public health, one of the dreams of the public health administrators like Haven Emerson was that there be a health unit in every county in the United States. And this health unit that Haven Emerson dreamed about in every county would have, as a minimum, a director of health, a physician, a sanitarian or a sanitary engineer, a public health nurse, and a clerk. And as a matter of fact, my first experience in county public health work in the war area outside in Missouri
uh-huh.
was to establish two of those basic four-person health units in counties that never had a health service before. Now, the public
assigned
health
assigned there by the public health service to do that. To
help I was
build
assigned
a,
there.
Build a structure.
I was assigned there, but the other persons were employed by the state and the county.
I see. Mm-hmm.
This was really reflected in the structure of the public health service at the time too, because for the most part, the structure of the public health service was not for categorical programs, excepting for VD and then later TB, mm-hmm. cancer on the Cancer Institute. But the basic structure of the public health service in those days was kind of to support the core basic infrastructure for public health around through the country. We wanted to be sure there were good state health departments. So we had a general public health grant.
Mm-hmm.
we wanted to support the development of county health units, city health units. And that was kind of the emphasis. So we had public health education, public health nursing, and general public health in the program.
Mm-hmm.
As those services in the states and counties developed, it became appropriate, and the services program enlarged and gave emphasis to some of the special technique programs, such as you have here at CDC.
Mm-hmm.
And the state agencies were big enough so that the other kinds of programs were kind of downplayed. I think in some instances there's still a need for support and backup and participation with the states and cities in certain areas of the country on special problems in those areas. And I think you at CDC have them.
Mm-hmm.
Lead paint.
Right.
You still have lead paint?
Yes, sir, we do. We don't have a grant.
I don't mean you don't have the lead paint, but you...
We don't have a grant for that program, but we do have a technical group, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You did have a grant program.
We did,
yeah.
Right.
Rat control?
Rat control.
Yeah.
Both those grants were put into a block grant recently, but we still have a basic kind of technical competence in that area, in those areas. As you said earlier, you fit right into the middle in terms of the directors of CDC. If someone had asked you back then, what's the future of CDC? What would have been your answer? And how does that fit with what actually happened?
I recall when we were developing the building program, the planning and the actual construction program, that there were there were already some activities at CDC which were kind of peripheral to communicable disease control. The emphasis in the Ken Quarterman, Larry Hall, Jack Hayes operation on chemical effects,
pesticides
mm-hmm. Weed control mechanisms, and so on. That was one illustration. But it was also interesting that I found right here, it had started under Ted Bauer or somebody before him, burgeoning activity in laboratory techniques that might be improved for the diagnosis of other conditions and communicable disease conditions. I am sorry that I again do not remember the names of the persons, but in the laboratory activity there was a laboratory unit which was working on the laboratory diagnosis of myocardial infarctions through chemical
Jerry
techniques.
Cooper?
Jerry Cooper and
Jerry
Marta
Cooper.
Candless or
Candler.
Candler,
right.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And they also were working on the diagnosis of liver disease through mm-hmm. chemical means.
Right.
Those are three examples, and there probably are others that I recall, where really we were out into something that was a little beyond what we would have done if we were adhering strictly to communicable disease activities. So as we talked about this, Alan Donaldson and Larry Smith and George Tremmel and Len Abbey and George Stenhouse, we said, well, maybe we ought to change the name for the Communicable Disease Center.
Really?
We want
to
keep the identity of CDC. So how can we do this? Well, the proposal was that we call it the Center for Disease Control. Mm-hmm. And we launched a feeler up the chain, and no, this wasn't such a good idea.
I see. But because that idea was floated in your mind.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know all the reasons, mm-hmm. but I can imagine that after all, there were chronic diseases
programs.
TB was still up there, accident prevention,
right,
a whole number of
other activities
up there, uh-huh. including radiological health and occupational health and so on. So the Center for Disease Control didn't fly
but
at
it
that
was,
time.
It was broached at
we talked
your
about
time.
It. We
Is
talked
right?
about it, and we were attracted to the idea.
But you were told, well, you're getting a little bit too ambitious
right.
too soon.
Well, we had to get our prime objective done, and that was to get the place built and established, and we did. I was delighted to see subsequent chiefs move on in these areas. Larry, and whom I'd known from the water days, and Dave Sensor, whom I knew from my TB days.
Right. Yeah. Okay.
Jim Goddard, who I knew from accident prevention days and special health services. And I did get to meet Bill Fagey in connection with his experiences in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. By this time, I was with the TB and Respiratory Disease Association, and the International Union wanted to propose, in connection with the Biafra War concept, a vaccination program on tuberculosis.
Oh.
So the director of the International Union Against Tuberculosis and I visited, I don't remember if it was called AID at that time, Agency for International Development in Washington. I think Jim Schaefer was in the program there mm-hmm. at AID mm-hmm. at that time. And Bill Fagey was in from Nigeria, and he came to the meeting, and we talked about this possibility. we didn't get anything nailed down at that meeting, but anyway, I got to meet Bill and was very impressed with mm-hmm. what he was doing in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. And of course, your present chief, Jim Mason, he came into the Epidemic Intelligence Service program when I was chief at CDC.
That's right.
And so
you've known
I think, yeah, I've known every chief of CDC from its inception up to the present.
Well, the time's passing when people are going to be able to say that. I could
yes.
say that, too. I knew,
yes.
I knew them all,
yeah.
but not many people in the future are going to be able to say that. So. Do you have anything else that you would like to get on the record?
Well, I'm supposed to talk for an hour and a half.
And we've talked for an hour and 15 minutes, I think.
An hour and 50?
Hour 15.
15?
Right.
One of the things that we did mention was the role that CDC has played with regard to health problems that are peculiar to certain areas. And we talked about the Savannah Laboratory as being an outgrowth of the activities in connection with the malaria control in war areas.
Mm-hmm.
If I remember right, Bill, that laboratory was housed in a building that was a hospital and was used as a VD rapid treatment center.
That's right.
In World War II.
That's exactly right. That building, those buildings were built as a railroad retirement home originally, and when that approach to housing retired railroad workers went by the board, the VD program got those buildings for a rapid treatment center during the war, and then subsequently it was turned over to CDC. as a laboratory. That's right. And we've closed that those buildings out now, and part of your original plan, at least part of it, has taken place. We've consolidated Montgomery, and that was done
that was
here,
my time.
Right, yes.
Yeah, we
And Savannah. So
the Montgomery lab, I think, has a little interesting history. It originally was part of a military facility, and then the Rockefeller Institute took it over, and the Public Health Service got it from the Rockefeller Institute, and Morris Schaefer and Jim Payne and Earl Arnold and Ernie Turkle in rabies, Charlie Shepard in leprosy, set up the viral and rickettsial laboratory there. Mm-hmm. And in the planning for this, and especially with the urgency of the Asian flu epidemic, we had to expand our virus activities for the influenza virus. And rather than doing it in Montgomery, Shackelford and company out at Chambly redid a whole building into it. Really, it was a good
virology laboratory.
Yeah, that's right.
We had some very efficient laboratories at Chambly in those
old
buildings.
Oh, yes.
Sure, yeah.
So we got that activity going, and as I said, the Dave Garraway and the Today Show took that occasion to, which, so far as I know, was the first time that CDC really had a big public impact on the American people with regard to a health problem, in which he...
That was the flu?
The Asian flu epidemic, 1957.
Right.
Where Dave Garraway's Today Show crew came down and interviewed people and put it out on the morning program all over the country. Mm-hmm. So people, along with their coffee, got a little health information.
CDC, all right. Yeah.
Right. But since then, I think your information program is good.
Oh, yes.
And I take real pleasure in reading about the things that you're doing down here, not just in communicable diseases, but environmental problems, other problems.
Agent Orange.
Agent Orange, yeah. So we had the Montgomery Laboratory. We set up a laboratory out in Phoenix to work on diarrheal problems in the desert country, particularly amongst the Indians. Mel Goodwin went out there from Sib Simmons Technology Branch. We had the Kansas City Laboratory with Leo Furcolo and Tom Chin on histoplasmosis and on virus diseases. We had activities going in Utah and Colorado, which we combined at Fort Collins, on the overwintering of the encephalitis viruses. The Arctic Health Research Center came into contact with us. In Wenatchee, Oregon,
we had a
pesticide monitoring activity with the purpose being to determine the effects of the use of the arsenicals at that time on sprayers and upon the apple fruit in that area. Griff Quinby was the head guy in that operation.
Exactly.
So those were illustrations. Oh, and we also had a schistosomiasis activity going in Puerto Rico. Dr. Ferguson was in charge of that. Mm-hmm. In addition, we'd begun to involve the Epidemic Intelligence Service in overseas operations. I believe it was in my time here when Dr. Langmuir worked with the CETO countries in connection with the surveillance of cholera in the Southeast Asian countries.
Right. And Bruce Dull?
Yes.
I think he was a young EIS officer and was a member of the group that went over there to do that, right? I've heard him tell that story. Yeah.
So we were spread out in many different ways. But talking about Senator Hill, we mentioned the virus and rickettsial laboratory being in Montgomery, and I mentioned the moving of the flu activity over here and the development of this activity and our plans to close up Montgomery. Well, we didn't announce to Senator Hill that we were going to close up this laboratory in Montgomery, Alabama, his state, right away, because we didn't know for sure whether
well,
we were
like
going to get the construction money and so
on.
So the time came when it was apparent that we had to talk to Senator Hill. Mm-hmm. And Dr. David Price, I think he was chief of the Bureau of State Services at the time, or he might have been deputy surgeon general, I'm not sure.
He held those jobs in that order.
Yes. I talked to him about it, and he decided that he and I should visit Senator Hill and bring him the news that we were going to close up this facility that employed some 30 or 40 people in Montgomery, Alabama. Well, we set up the appointment in Montgomery, at Senator Hill's Montgomery office. And Dave and I flew in there and went early one morning to Senator Hill's office, and Dave announced to him that we had some news for him. And Senator Hill said, well, he was always glad to hear about news. So Dave told him that we were going to close the laboratory. Senator Hill says, that is not the kind of news that I want to hear from you. He says, the only kind of news that I want to hear on this score is that you're bringing something to Alabama, that you're locating something in Alabama. So the mission was not exactly successful. But it so happened that at that same time, the radiological health program was being expanded, which was in the same Bureau of State Services I think it was under Dave, was looking to expand its sampling and testing activities and its support for states. So they needed a facility. And Rad Health and Dr. Price decided that with the leaving of Morris Schaefer and Company from the Rickettsial Laboratory from the Montgomery scene, that Rad Health would move into that facility. And I don't know whether that's still there or not.
I had forgotten that, too.
It worked because, as I say, I went on into the environmental programs, and I had Rad Health as one of them. It worked for us very well. It served the southeastern part of the United States in connection with fallout, sampling of foods, testing of biological specimens, and so on. So
you, in effect, made a trade with Senator Hill.
Yeah, right. No, I didn't make the trade. I had nothing to give him at the time, but Dave Price did.
But the Public Health Service did. One thing that you haven't mentioned, and it may not be something that you would want to mention personally, but if I remember, you were the first chief of CDC to get the rank of Assistant Surgeon General. Am I right on that?
That is true. That in the spring of 1957, Dr. Burney, at that time, for the first time in the Public Health Service's history, made certain officers assistant surgeon generals and gave them star rank. And the chief of CDC was one, and I happened to be the chief of CDC at that time.
Well, you're being modest, but I think it was a reflection of what the Public Health Service thought of you and the fact that CDC was arriving in those days to that kind of stature. Well, we're about out of time, Dr. Anderson. Are there any last words that you would like to get on record before we run out of tape?
I don't think we need to say you and I to those who remain behind to keep up the good work. We know they're going to do it.
I know they will. Yeah. They sure will.
Well, thank you, Bill,
thank you
this opportunity.
Thank
to
you.